Hello world! In today's video, we'll understand the working of a gem-based DMA. If you haven't seen my previous videos on Gigabit Ethernet functionality, then now is the good time to first check those ones. I've explained everything step by step on how to make this whole Gigabit Ethernet thingy work on the Zboard. So check the playlist and the link will be in the description below. After watching those videos, come back to this one. Alright. So let's quickly do a recap of Ethernet data transfer. That is how the packets are received and transmitted. So the first thing is that the DMA fetches the data from a particular memory location and then passes the data onto a FIFO, which then sends it out to a MAC transmitter, which further sends out it through the file layer outside. So that's how the data is transmitted. Similarly, the file layer receives the data, which is then passed on to the MAC receiver, which then sends it out to a FIFO, and ultimately the DMA receives it and stores the data in a particular memory location. Now for each of these transactions, that is transmission and receiving of the data, the DMA interrupts the Zynq processing system. But more on that later. Now let's understand the role of DMA specifically. When we say that it saves the data in memory, what we really mean is that there's an allocated space in the memory, which is called as buffer, where the data can be stored or from where the data can be fetched for transmission. So that's our buffer region. Now obviously to save the data in a particular location, we would require the address of that location. So this is provided by the good old buffer descriptor. Thus each buffer descriptor points to a particular buffer. And both of them are stored in a memory location. So that means that there's a memory region allocated for both. We also need to have control over the buffer descriptor. That is which one is being processed currently and which buffer descriptor is next in queue. And that is precisely taken care of by the MAC registers. Now these are queue base address register and queue pointer register. Now the queue base address register always points to the first buffer descriptor in the buffer descriptor list. The queue pointer points to the next buffer descriptor after the conclusion of the current transaction, and it is incremented by the buffer descriptor length, that is two words in this case. When the queue pointer encounters the last buffer descriptor in the list, it wraps back to the first buffer descriptor in the list, that is the queue base address. Now one may wonder about the condition that is set on a buffer descriptor which makes it the last in the list, because at the moment we've only spoken about the address. So basically buffer descriptor is a structure which not only consists of the address of the buffer but a few other important status and control bits as well. Each buffer descriptor is composed of two 32-bit words, one for buffer address and other for configuration and status. And that brings us to the buffer descriptor entries. Now one thing to note is that there are separate buffers and buffer descriptors for transmission and for receiving of the data. So let's take a look at the RxBD, that is the receive buffer descriptor entries. First is obviously the address. Next is the wrap bit. And this is the bit that we were speaking about earlier. So as the name itself suggests, it's the bit which when set wraps the transaction. It indicates the last buffer descriptor in the list. And next is the ownership bit. Now again, the names are very, very self-explanatory for each of these bits. So this one, when it is used to check if the buffer is owned or if the data has been received already. It should be zero to write the data in a buffer. Otherwise, it is already owned. There is end of frame. Again, self-explanatory, indicates the end of the current frame. Similarly, there's a start of frame, which marks the beginning of a frame. Then there are other bits as well, which I'm not going to discuss because they aren't required for basic programming. If you are interested in advanced or additional functionality, then I'll suggest you check the Zynq manual for the same. Then comes the TxBD. Again, it consists of address. Then there is wrap bit, which is similar in functionality to the wrap bit of your receive buffer descriptor. Then there's used bit, which is similar to the ownership bit, which basically means that if it is set, the buffer data is already read or it's used. Hence, it must be cleared for transmission. Else, your hardware will interrupt with an error indication in case of transmission of a used buffer descriptor. Then there is this bit which is called as last bit, which is similar to the end of frame in RxBD. It indicates that the last buffer for the current frame has been reached. Then we also have length of the buffer. There's nothing really to explain in this. It's simply the length. And there are other bits as well. Again, for advanced functionality, refer the Zynq manual. Now, I wanted to make sure that the difference between end of frame and wrap is extremely clear. In case of receive buffer descriptor, we've got start of frame and end of frame. And we receive a number of frames like these. Now, the Ethernet frame length itself is variable. So, the number of buffer descriptors per frame also varies. Therefore, end of frame and start of frame basically helps us in keeping an exact count of the frames which are received. Note that end of frame has nothing to do with the end of transaction, or in other words, the number of frames that are received. The continuity of the transaction depends on the number of buffer descriptors in the list and not on the end of frame. And the last descriptor, as we've already discussed, is described by the wrap bit. Therefore, wrap would decide the end, or the number of buffer descriptors in the list would be the deciding factor for the completion of the transaction. So the DMA engine wraps back to the first BD due to the wrap bit. End of frame is only the end of the frame and not the end of the transaction. Similarly, in case of TXBD, we've got the last bit, which indicates the last buffer for the current frame and again not the end of the transaction. So I hope that the difference is absolutely clear. Now the buffer descriptors can be in four different states at any given moment, and they transition in a particular way for the DMA transfers. So let's quickly understand the flow. First of all, a list of buffer descriptors, that is a collection, is known as buffer descriptor ring. And what that means in programming terminology is it's a linked list, and the last buffer descriptor in the ring is linked to the first buffer descriptor in the ring. And the ring is created using the function called as bdRingCreate of the XEMACPS driver. And they are all in free or idle state in the beginning, and they can be allocated by the application using the buffer descriptor ring allocate function. This function allows the application to gain control over the buffer descriptors, and then they transition into the pre-process or pre-work state. The application can configure them, for example, by specifying the buffer address and other entries which were discussed previously. Thus, the application prepares them for the DMA transactions. Then, the descriptors are enqueued to hardware using toHardware function. And from there, they go to the hardware or transition to the work state in which they are under hardware control. And they can be in a state of awaiting hardware processing, in process, or processed by hardware. The application shouldn't change the buffer descriptors while they are under hardware control, as doing so can cause data corruption and it can also lead to system instability. So you have to be very cautious while programming. After the completion of the DMA transaction, the buffer descriptors obviously remain in the hardware until the user application regains or reclaims the control or extracts them from the hardware. Thus, they transition into the post-process or work state when we use from hardware function. Here, the application can find out about the transfer status by checking the status word of each buffer descriptor. Thus, the application infers whether the transaction was successful or not. Finally, the buffer descriptors are freed by the application using the ring free function, and they remain in this free state until the next cycle initiates. Now, when a DMA transfer is to be cancelled before enqueuing it to the hardware, then the application can return the requested buffer descriptors to the free group again using the BD ring unallocate function. So with this ends the first part of this series on Gigabit Ethernet DMA, In the next part, or part 2 of the series, we'll analyze in depth the code which is used in the Ethernet example application with respect to the DMA functionality. Again, do check the 4-part series of Zynq Ethernet before proceeding, as the explanation provided there is a prerequisite for this series. Having said that, like the video if you found it helpful and share it as well. And it takes a lot of effort and perseverance to get these type of videos, or rather the content, ready for you. So please subscribe and support. And finally, bye world.